Well, we're going to pick up verse 17 where we left off, starting with the arrest of the apostles. Verse 17, then the high priest rose up and all those who were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and they were filled with indignation, or more literally jealousy, and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. The Sadducees were that sect in Judaism that were far more materialistic, far more worldly. They didn't believe in a lot of what the Bible taught. They didn't believe that the Word of God was anything beyond the first five books of the Law of Moses. So they didn't believe in resurrection and angels, and therefore they were living for this world, and they sought a lot of political power for themselves under the Roman Empire, and they did have much clout as Rome gave them a degree of freedom to run the temple and to profit from it. And so they are furious that their command that they had given the apostles back in chapter 4, don't teach in Jesus' name anymore, was not being obeyed. So they arrest them. But now we see that an angel is going to appear. Verse 19, at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. And when they heard that, they entered the temple early in the morning and they taught. We're told in the Bible that angels are spirit beings that were created by God to minister to those who are the heirs of salvation, his people. Of course, one of those angels didn't like that plan. We know him as Satan or the devil, originally known as Lucifer, and he rebelled against God. And the Bible would suggest that he brought as many as a third of all the created angels with him in the rebellion against God, which, of course, means that two-thirds of the angels remain loyal and faithful to God, and there are millions of them. And in addition to their great power, as we see here, they show up, they open the prison doors. But primarily, angels are messengers in the Bible. In fact, the word angel comes straight from the Greek, angelos, and that word means messenger. And so often when we see them appearing, as we do here, yes, they're at work, but also they're proclaiming a message. And in this case, the angel is saying, go back out in the temple and keep on preaching. And so we see that the apostles obey the message, and they do so. Now, one word for clarification, so there's no confusion. In the Old Testament, we read about the angel of the Lord, definite. And the angel of the Lord, we notice when he shows up, is an appearance of God in the Old Testament. Often as the appearance of a man, as angels often do. Now, there should not be confusion because, again, the angel of the Lord, or you could say the messenger of the Lord, because that is what is taking place in those occasions. For example, the angel of the Lord came to Samson's parents, before there was a Samson, announcing that they were going to have a son. They wanted him to be a Nazarite from the womb. That was the command from the angel of the Lord. And Samson's dad freaked out. He said, we've seen God face to face. Because they recognized there was this divine appearance. But that does not somehow mean that Jesus is an angel, as some groups mistakenly teach. In fact, once the incarnation takes place, the virgin birth, when God became a man, not just appeared as a man, became flesh and dwelt among us, we no longer ever again in the Bible see an appearance of the angel of the Lord, because Jesus became a man forever. So, this is just a regular angel. Notice, an angel appears and performs this work and gives this message. So you can imagine the astonishment of the leadership. I stopped in halfway through verse 21. But the high priest and those with him came and called the council together with all the elders of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and did not find them in the prison, they returned and reported, saying, indeed, we found the prison shut securely, and the guards standing outside before the doors, but when we opened them, we found no one inside. Now when the high priest, the captain of the temple, and the chief priests heard these things, they wondered what the outcome would be. So one came and told them, saying, look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and they're teaching the people. Now it's important to recognize that this leadership thought that they were the representatives of God. Their actions were what God wanted done. So you can imagine, in their minds, we're going to arrest these guys. We're going to throw them in prison. We're going to interrogate them. That's what God would want. And yet, is it what God wants? Apparently not, because God sends an angel and performs a miracle, a true miracle, in delivering them from this prison. And you can imagine the shock. Here they are. They open the doors. They're going to go get them. And the room's empty. The prison's empty. They're not there. And then they find out, oh yeah, guys are out there in the temple again. They're preaching some more. So their astonishment turns to anger rather quickly. Verse 26, then the captain went with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people lest they should be stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council. And the high priest asked them, saying, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? Look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. And you intend to bring this man's blood on us. So they got him without violence, implying that often there was some violence involved when there was an arrest by the temple guard. But they were afraid of the crowds. They didn't want the crowds to get upset and end up stoning them. And notice the apostles go with them peacefully. There's not a big battle or a resistance. But isn't it interesting how often unbelievers are still very respectful of faithful, bold Christians who walk what they talk. It's a mistake to assume that everyone who's not a Christian is going to hate you. That's just not true. When I went to college my freshman year, lived in the dorms there at University of Oklahoma, big university, and as you can imagine, a state like Oklahoma, there were some Christians on my floor, and these guys were friends, and we would play intramurals together, and we got tired of cafeteria food, go on a Burger King run or something, and go to the football game on Saturday and sit together. But of course then at nighttime, when some of us were looking to get into trouble and find ways that we could do things we shouldn't do, you know, they went study and went to bed early. And see, they lived the life. I knew they were Christians. They knew I wasn't interested. They didn't shun me. They were friends. But they didn't compromise their own walk. And I had respect for that, even though I was totally an unbeliever. I didn't want anything to do with it. So don't underestimate the influence that your life can have with your unbelieving friends and family around you just by simply walking what you talk and really living what you believe. Look at the respect that a man like Billy Graham enjoys in our country. Consistently one of the most highly respected individuals in our entire country. Do you realize that throughout Billy Graham's career, his strongest critics have been pastors and other religious leaders? It hasn't been the unbelievers. Oh, there's always something to complain about. Well, he's using that church to help organize his crusade and shouldn't participate with them. You know, anyone who thinks that Billy Graham is somehow an enemy of the gospel needs to get out more and get a passport and go travel around the world a little bit. How ridiculous. He doesn't compromise the gospel message. I've heard too many of them, and I've read too many of his books and articles. He doesn't compromise the message against sin and proclaiming Jesus Christ. And yet, what do we have here? The multitudes, many unbelievers, they have respect for these early Christians. It's the religious leaders that are hung up.